50 years. That's a long time. For a human. Not so much for a Vulcan. And for a red shirt? Well, let's face it, 50 years is just an aspirational goal. Yet, here we are, at 50 years of Star Trek. What is it about this franchise that has kept us coming back since that first September night in 1966?
The following program is brought to you in living color on NBC.
What is the secret to Star Trek's success? How did it survive its banishment to syndication? Why did it flourish and come back even stronger? How is it that we're able to celebrate not only a legacy of virtually countless adventures in all manner of media, but to look ahead to a future that might be just as bright as the past? Maybe it's the way we fought with protests and letter-writing campaigns to keep the original Star Trek on the air. It made us feel protective of Gene Roddenberry's project, his wagon train to the stars. But can that be it? There are Star Trek fans who weren't even born when the Starship Enterprise first navigated the tumultuous universe of the 60s. Maybe it's something visual. There has always been something different about the way Star Trek looks. Nowhere was that more apparent than on the sets Matt Jeffries and his team created for the original series, all fitted onto a cramped Desilu soundstage.
This is a model, scale model. The red represents the stage walls, stage 9 at the original Desilu lot. And at a quarter inch to the foot, these are all of the sets that we had for the interior of the Starship Enterprise. This is the bridge with two of the typical units pulled out. Engineering, our corridor, and the infamous Jeffries tube there. This is Kirk's quarters and his office. The briefing room is over here. Sick bay down in the end, it's green. And Dr. McCoy's exam room. His office, Dr. McCoy's lab, and the famous transporter room is over here.
But if visuals are the key, it doesn't explain some of the more questionable choices that have been made over the years. Perhaps aliens are the key. After all, there have been hundreds of them. But it seems that for every elaborate Tellarite, classic or new, there's been a Bandy, or a Bajoran, or a Baku. Maybe it's just about the space battles. No. If we want to understand the secret of Star Trek success, we have to step back and see the bigger picture. Star Trek's appeal begins with the notion that we can step onto a transporter pad or board a shuttle and go anywhere. From the smoke-filled halls of Kronos to the searing heat of Vulcan, the Mutara Nebula, or even all the way to Galaxy M33. Star Trek is about exploring strange new worlds, seeking out new civilizations. Not to conquer, not to control, simply to make contact.
Someday, my people are going to come up with some sort of a doctrine. Something that tells us what we can and can't do out here. Should and shouldn't do. But until somebody tells me that they've drafted that directive, I'm going to have to remind myself every day that we didn't come out here to play God.
Uneventful.
Admiral?
It's the way you describe the survey of Nibiru in your captain's log.
Yes, sir. I didn't want to waste your time going over the details.
Tell me more about this volcano. The data says it was highly volatile. If it were to erupt, it would wipe out the planet.
Let's hope it doesn't, sir.
Something tells me it won't.
Well, sir, volatile is all relative. Maybe our data was off.
Or maybe it didn't erupt because Mr. Spock detonated a cold fusion device inside it right after a civilization that's barely invented the wheel happened to see a starship rising out of their ocean. That is pretty much how you describe it, is it not?
We once were as you are. Spears, arrows. There came a time when our weapons grew faster than our wisdom, and we almost destroyed ourselves. We learned from this to make a rule during all our travels. Never to cause the same to happen to other worlds. We are wise enough to know that we are wise enough not to interfere in the way of a man or another world.
You must let the villagers destroy us.
Beverly, the Prime Directive is not just a set of rules. It is a philosophy, and a very correct one. History has proved again and again that whenever mankind interferes with a less developed civilization, no matter how well-intentioned that interference may be, the results are invariably disastrous.
It's hard to be philosophical when faced with suffering.
Believe me, Beverly, there was only one decision. Resume.
But as much as Star Trek is about space, it's also about our home, Earth. Something we're reminded of every time crew members return to Sector 001, no matter the time period.
This is the 5:30 news summary, Cape Kennedy. The first manned moonshot is scheduled for Wednesday, 6 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. All three astronauts who are to make this historic...
Manned moonshot. That was in the late 1960s.
Apparently, Captain, so are we.
What?
Or how awkward the situation.
Well, Catherine, you got us home.
Right place, wrong time. But it is good to be back, nevertheless.
Maybe I should look up a few ancestors. As I recall, one of them was a school teacher in Arizona.
I don't know what my relatives were doing this far back in
Coming
history.
Through. Sorry.
For all I know, she could be my great-great-great-great-grandmother.
She does have your legs.
Have you ever been to Southern California, Chakotay?
No.
After the Hermosa quake in 2047, this entire region sank under 200 meters of water. It became one of the world's largest coral reefs, home to thousands of different marine species.
Some interesting species in this century.
Look out, will you? Why don't you watch where you're going?
Have you ever operated a vehicle from this period?
I can pilot a starship.
Hey, why don't you watch where you're going, you dumbass?
Well, a double dumbass on you!
Welcome to Earth. We mean you no harm.
Did you understand a word of that?
Our universal translators must be malfunctioning.
What are they doing?
Maybe it's some kind of greeting.
She may be honest with nothing.
What are they doing?
Maybe their universal translators are broken too.
It's also why the greatest threats often center right here on our pale blue dot.
Data, report.
We appear to be caught in a temporal wake.
Captain, Earth.
The atmosphere contains high concentrations of methane, carbon monoxide, and fluorine.
Life signs?
Population approximately 9 billion. All Borg.
All planetary defense systems have just gone inoperative.
Thank you.
planet Earth at all costs. Farewell.
Star Trek is about accepting the wide variety of life that exists all around us.
If I ever made you feel that you couldn't be yourself with me, I'm sorry. I want to know you. The way you really are.
It's about accepting and embracing infinite diversity in infinite combinations.
Captain, why did you build a translator with a feminine voice?
We didn't.
But I heard...
The idea of male and female are universal constants, Cochrane. There's no doubt about it. The companion is female.
Her attitude when she approaches you is profoundly different than when she contacts us. Her appearance is soft. Gentle. Her voice is melodic, pleasing. I do not totally understand the emotion, but it obviously exists. The companion loves you.
Do you know what you're saying? For all these years, I've let something as alien as that crawl around inside me, into my mind, my feelings.
What are you complaining about? It kept you alive, didn't it?
That thing fed on me, used me. It's disgusting.
There's nothing disgusting about it. It's just another life form, that's all. You get used to those things.
You're as bad as it is.
Your highly emotional reaction is most illogical. Your relationship with the companion has for 150 years been emotionally satisfying, eminently practical, and totally harmless. It may indeed have been quite beneficial.
Is this what the future holds? Men who have no notion of decency or morality? Well, maybe I'm 150 years out of style, but I'm not going to be fodder for any inhuman monster.
I am female. I was born that way. I have had those feelings, those longings, all of my life. It is not unnatural. I am not sick because I feel this way. I do not need to be helped. I do not need to be cured.
You asked me once why I married your mother. I married her because I loved her.
Star Trek is about accepting the reality that sometimes our worst enemy is ourselves.
What's the matter with me? Judging from my observations, Captain, you're rapidly losing the power of decision.
You have a point, Spock?
Yes, always, Doctor. We have here an unusual opportunity to appraise the human mind, or to examine, in Earth terms, the roles of good and evil in a man. His negative side, which you call hostility, lust, violence. And his positive side, which Earth people express as compassion, love, tenderness.
It's the captain's guts you're analyzing. Are you aware of that, Spock?
Yes. And what is it that makes one man an exceptional leader? We see here indications that it is his negative side which makes him strong.
that his evil side, if you will, properly controlled and disciplined, is vital to his strength. Your negative side, removed from you, the power of command begins to elude you. If I seem insensitive to what you're going through, Captain, understand, it's the way I am.
Our irrational fears.
No. And no is a word that Starfleet better get used to hearing from now on. Because up until today, it's always been yes, hasn't it? Yes, yes, go right ahead, roam the stars. Yes, inform potentially hostile species of the whereabouts of Earth. Yes, and trust the entire future of our world to non-human creatures who don't even feel like we do. Yes, promote the total degradation of mankind by encouraging alien-human relations. Well, yes is a word that ends here and now. I am returning Earth to its rightful owners. I am giving Earth back to humanity, back to human beings. It is my life's work. It is what I was born to do. And there is no one, not an alien, not a human, that will stop me from achieving it.
Our lust for control.
Why don't you tell me who you are? Who you work for? I think it's obvious. Same people you work for, the Federation, Starfleet. You don't expect me to believe you're with Internal Affairs, do you? Let's just say I belong to another branch of Starfleet Intelligence. Our official designation is Section 31. Never heard of it. We keep a low profile. Works out better that way for all concerned.
And what does Section 31 do?
We search out and identify potential dangers to the Federation.
And once identified?
We deal with them.
How?
Quietly.
So if I had been a Dominion agent, what would have happened to me?
We wouldn't be standing here having this conversation.
Starfleet sanctions what you're doing.
We don't submit reports or ask approval for specific operations, if that's what you mean. We are an autonomous department.
Authorized by whom?
Section 31 was part of the original Starfleet Charter.
But that was 200 years ago. Are you telling me you've been working on your own ever since? Without specific orders? Accountable to nobody but yourselves?
You make it sound so ominous.
And it reminds us that no matter how far we go, there is always a chance that we can stumble along the way.
How long have you been a doctor? Nearly 40 years. And in all that time, did you ever do anything you thought was unethical? Twice. Why? I'm about to step over a line. A line I thought I would never cross. And given the nature of our mission, it probably won't be the last.
Probably not. May I ask what you're planning to do?
There could be more casualties.
I'll be ready.
Star Trek is about telling engaging stories. The bittersweet romance of City on the Edge of Forever.
Whatever it is, let me help.
Let me help. 100 years or so from now, I believe, a famous novelist will write a classic using that theme. He'll recommend those three words even over I love you.
Centuries from now? Who is he? Where does he come from? Where will he come from?
Silly question. Want to hear a silly answer?
Yes.
A planet
circling that far left star in Orion's belt. See?
The pathos of the visitor.
Jake, they'll have me fixed up in no time. How are you doing? It's all right. Everything's going to be all right.
I thought it was a dream.
What was?
When I saw you in my quarters, I should have felt you were alive. I should have known it.
It's not your fault, Jake. I'm here now. That's what matters.
We're losing him.
Look at me. I need to know you're going to be all right.
His temporal signature is fluctuating. I need that containment field now, Chief. Right away. Field active. It's not working.
Jake.
Dad. I'm gonna try locking onto him with the transporter beam. Don't leave me.
Or the inner light.
The rest of us have been gone 1,000 years. If you remember what we were and how we lived, then we'll have found life again. Tell them of us, my darling.
And we love to cheer when our heroes save the day.
Captain, I picked up another ship.
And sometimes, it's just about the music.
No, I don't play the piano.
You want to bet? Stay with me, Pally.
Well, you don't need me. The piano's doing all the work.
That's not the point. You've got to sell it. Style, baby, style. Make it believe.
Style.
Come fly with me. Come fly. Let's fly away. If you can use some exotic booze at a bar in far Bombay, come fly with me, come fly, let's fly away. Come fly with me, let's take off to Peru. In Llama Land, there's a one-man band that he'll toot his flute for you. Fly with me, let's take off in the blue. Once I get you up there, where the air is rarefied, we'll just glide, starry eyed. Once I get you up there, I'll be holding you. You may hear together. Weather-wise, it's such a lovely day. You just say the words and we'll beat the birds down to Acapulco Bay. It's perfect for a flying honeymoon, they say. Come fly with me, let's fly away. Once I get you up there, where the air is rarefied, we'll just glide, starry-eyed. Once I get you up there, I'll be holding you. Cause we're together, weather-wise, it's such a lovely day. Just say the words and we'll beat the birds down to Acapulco Bay. It's perfect for a flying honeymoon, they say.
But above all, it's about having unforgettable companions along for the journey. Some who have surprised us with their return. And some who have journeyed with us for all too short a time. But the trek continues. What is it about Star Trek that has kept our attention for 50 years? It's something that resonates within us. It's the promise of a tomorrow that is better than today. It's the idea that we can be better. That we will be better.
You've restored my father's faith.
And you've restored my son's.
That we will see the folly of our ways and correct them. That we will find ways to remind ourselves to never repeat them.
Then the Prime Directive is in full force, Captain?
No identification of self or mission. No interference with the social development of said planet.
No references to space or the fact that there are other worlds or more advanced civilizations.
Let's go.
It's an idea that gets handed down, one fan to the next. For this is our future. No matter the profile of the vessel or the look of the uniform, with Star Trek, we know we are someplace special, both strange and completely familiar. It's a place that shares a common history with itself. With us.
When Zefram Cochrane made his legendary warp flight 90 years ago and drew the attention of our new friends, the Vulcans, we realized that we weren't alone in the galaxy. Today, we are about to cross a new threshold. For nearly a century, we've waded ankle deep in the ocean of space. Now it's finally time to swim. Rather than quoting Dr. Cochran, I think we should listen to his own words from the dedication ceremony for the Warp 5 complex 32 years ago.
On this site, a powerful engine will be built. An engine that will someday help us to travel 100 times faster than we can today. Imagine it. Thousands of inhabited planets at our fingertips. And we'll be able to explore those strange new worlds and seek out new life and new civilizations. This engine will let us go boldly where no man has gone before.
Sir?
Out there. That-a-way.
It speaks to some basic human needs that there is a tomorrow. It's not all going to be over with a big flash and a bomb. That the human race is improving. That we have things to be proud of. As humans. No, ancient astronauts did not build the pyramids. Human beings built them because they're clever and they work hard. And Star Trek is about those things. We're going to make it. Because it says the human adventure has just begun. That's it in a nutshell.